First of all, thank you so much for having me here. It's indeed a very special occasion. 18 years ago, 1996, we performed the Blue Jewel here the very same first weekend in May. It was, I think it was the 3rd of May of 1996 when we performed the Blue Jewel. It was the first time I got a chance to speak at St. John's congregation, and when I read the narrative of the Blue Jewel, the choir stood here and sang and danced in front here. Then 10 years ago during this very same weekend when we performed, it was the 2nd of May, we performed Shanti here in the very same sanctuary. So it's the 10th anniversary, so going by the spirit of what Reverend Peter said, hopefully this is a conversation that will go on for decades to come. So it's an honor for me to be here speaking in front of all of you, and it's a privilege to be able to bring our singers here to present some concepts that are very close to our heart, and also to share some ideas of the Hindu religion, particularly from a Vedantic standpoint. I don't want to drop too much jargon here, but actually share some ideas which I think will provide a platform for all of us to relate to in a very powerful way. So India is home to many different religions, tons of religions in fact, and more can probably be born. There's room for more religions also. There's no stop, there's nothing that says, okay, this is the end of it. I'm going to quote art historian Michael Wood in one of his documentaries on PBS, where he said, the fundamental question that all religions try to answer is, how do we make good people out of people? Okay, and I think that's the way where most religions are headed. And of course, sometimes we lose track of that. But in the Hindu religion, the quest can be boiled down to three different questions. Apart from the code of conduct, dharma, which just goes around to say what goes around, which just says what goes around comes around. So your code of conduct is defined by what you do not want others to do to you. It's as simple as that. And the greatest of all virtues is what's called ahimsa, which is non-violence, which Gandhi followed to the core. So it's like you don't want to inflict harm upon anyone in any way, shape, or form. Because the simple reason is that you do not want any harm inflicted upon yourself. I don't want anybody to do anything bad to me, so I don't want to do anything bad to anybody else too. Okay, so the fundamental questions in Hinduism are, who am I? Which is a question we ask in Shanti. Kuta iyam srishtihi, kuta ajata, all that stuff. So who am I? What is this creation? What is our evolution? So, what is everything that surrounds me? What is this reality that I call jagat? And how did all this come into being? These are the three questions that are central truth to human inquiry, which are answered, which are forever being inquired into in Hinduism. One main difference, Reverend Mitra requested me to have this be not only a musical concept, but also a forum where we share ideas, so which is the reason I've written a narrative before every composition that we present. And I'm going to request the choir to take a position here. While they're doing, so I just want to give a brief introduction to the Hindu religion itself. The Hindu, whenever we hear Indian music, we listen to a drone. This drone is referred to as a shruti. What shruti means, that which is heard. And the word Shruti also refers to the scriptures of the Hindu religion, which are never in doubt, which were never in doubt. This is in total contrast to the Abrahamic tradition, where everything goes by the book. Yes, we go in the West, we go by the bibliographic tradition, by the biblical tradition, where everything is by the book, everything is written down. So, whereas in the Indian tradition, it's pretty much true. What is heard and what is revealed, what was revealed to the seers and the sages who shared this knowledge, who reasoned it out and shared it out and then developed very beautiful chants which were then passed down from generation to generation to such a point that we even have them with us and we are able to share them with all humanity. Now, there's many different popular devotional traditions in Hinduism, but one that a couple, an idea that's shared across all traditions is the concept of what's called Anada Brahma. I'm going to go a little to the side if it's possible so that it may seem, or maybe a quiet and move to that side. This is the first time we have a male majority choir, I think. So there's many different popular devotional traditions because there's no simple, there's nothing that defines how you can relate to the source, and I can come to that in just a bit. But then one thing that we would like to share with you and invite the audience to participate is in the recognition of the cosmic energy, which is the source of all manifest reality. Everything that we see around us, the material reality that we see around us, the life around us, we, who we are, and the entire universe was manifested out of this cosmic energy, which is the unmanifest reality. And this cosmic reality that we refer to as the sound energy, Om. And it is from this Om that music emanated. It is the source of Om, without which you don't have music. Without Om, without the sound, you don't have dance, without this you don't have poetry, without this you don't have language, without this you don't have life itself. So the first composition we are going to be presenting is one that salutes this reality, Om. So I'm going to request the Dinesh to play the track, but even before that, we can have the Shruti on in free shot. He also resurrected, that's not the right word to use, but he left his body, he entered the body of another person. So it's like in the Indian way of life, Beneath said, you are not your body, and this is not your only life. You, me, am beyond this. I am illusioned by layers and layers of ignorance that do not allow me to realize what my true life, true self is. And it's only by peeling away on these layers of ignorance that I realize what my true self is. We'll get to that in just a second. And so the idea of you, the idea of me being my body, to enter another body as long as it's available, is it's not unusual or not unencountered in the Indian tradition. So somebody had asked me a question many years ago. Has anybody ever come back from the dead in India? I said, yeah. So it's like, death is not believed to be the end at all. It's just believed to be an event in the ongoing cycle of life and death. In fact, death is even celebrated in a place like Banaras. And that's where we're going in our next composition. This is a composition written by Adi this composition was written by this philosopher in the holy city of Banaras on the banks of the river Ganga. The Ganga is something that everybody here is familiar with, thanks to the Ganga composition that we do in Shanti. And this is in praise of the universal mother, who is the sustainer of all of life. So in Indian reality, God is both male and female, and people get into that again. So we're going to sing this composition for you as a congregation in unison. Reverend and I went through a series of questions which we thought would be great to address during this occasion. One of the questions he asked was, what is the difference in the conceptualization of God between the Abrahamic traditions and the Hindu tradition? And this is there's a lot of answers. We can debate this for days together. This is something that we all would really enjoy talking about. But here's something I'm going to say based on my understanding. I'm not a pastor, I'm not a religious teacher, but having worked on these musical creations like Shanti, I'm able to answer these questions to the best of my ability. So here's the understanding of the Abrahamic model of religions. There's always a founder. There is a God who is the most superior power you can think of. And there's a location for the God, for this God. It's always away from where we are. And there's a community that believes in God. And there is a book that contains the teachings to be followed. And there's always a prescribed code of conduct. In the Hindu way of looking at life, and in the Indian tradition, there is no distinct founder at all. So that is a very clear distinction, that Hinduism does not have a founder, number one. There is plenty of room for spiritual inquiry. In fact, you only challenge things and learn. You challenge existing beliefs. In fact, we define faith as acceptance of an idea that is subject to correction upon verification. So faith is defined as an acceptance of an idea that is subject to correction upon verification. So that is at the base of spiritual inquiry. In fact, spiritual inquiry is no different from scientific inquiry in the Indian tradition. And there's no distinct book. Although it's popularly assumed that the holy book of the Hindu religion is the Gita. I did not know that I was a Hindu until I entered grade 5, when my teacher told me, I went to a missionary school and my teacher told me that I was a Hindu. Because the word Hindu is a word that is more of a geographic origin, referring to people that live to the east of the river Sindhu, the Indus. So it was a name given by people outside of India because they saw so much of diversity in religious beliefs and practices. And there's so many different religions in India. For instance, the Shaiva religion connects to the source of the ultimate reality in the form of Shiva. The Vaishnava religion connects to the source of the ultimate reality in the form of Vishnu. So when you have so many different religions, there's no one distinct religious head at all. In fact, when I work on different projects, it's a lot easier when I work with one leader that can bring a lot of diverse groups together. So if something has to be conveyed, I convey to them. So when the colonizers came to India, they found it very difficult to convert this what is now 1.2 billion people into their faith, into their way of believing, because there was no one head that they could kill and cover the rest. Because it's like if you cut off one head, there were 1,000 other heads. And each of them, it was so diverse. I mean, that's the nature of India. Isn't that the nature of the universe itself? Diversity. And diversity is something that's celebrated by Hinduism, by the Hindu religion, as we call it. I mean, let's go with the name, okay? In all its splendor. So what is the nature of God in the Hindu tradition? So, first to get into the nature of who is God, I need to get into the nature of who am I, but I will reserve that for another service at some point in time. It's a much, much deeper question. Look for the order in the creation. There is so much of knowledge. Like for gravity, for example, it's defined not only as a physical force, but so much of gravity is not going to change whether you are in the Andaman Islands near India or in Mississauga or the floating on the Mississippi. It's going to be the same. So there are certain forces of nature, there's so much of built-in intelligence, our circulatory system, the way we think, what causes depression, what gets you out of it. What causes the human reproductive system to function? There's so much intelligence built into all of it. So if you look at the universe, the Upanishads believe that the entire universe, all of creation, is the work of a certain intelligent being. Okay? We don't want to use the word intelligent design here yet, but there's so much of design built into everything that you see. But then if you start reasoning out things a little logically, and if you look at iPhone. The iPhone is made by an iPhone maker, Apple, but it's also made by an intelligent being. This paper was made by somebody. And the church was built by somebody. I was made by my parents. And the tree was made from a seed. And so on and so forth. And if you look at any human-made objects, there's always a creator that is associated with it. Similarly, if you look at the universe, there is a creator that is associated with this creation. And we refer to the universe as sarvam, which is everything. So sarvasya karta sarvajnaha, which means the creator of the universe, is one who knows everything about the universe. But now, where is this creator? There is a very fundamental question. Is he sitting somewhere beyond our perception? Because just by the word universe, we define everything that exists, absolutely everything that exists. If somebody had to create it, and if somebody was beyond the realm of this universe, then he or she had to be sitting somewhere else when they created this place. If so, did this bus, who created the seat on which this creator was sitting? So that is that is at the core of the Upanishadic inquiry. So what is concluded is that, what is reasoned out is that the creator of the universe is no different from the creation itself. The universe is, the creator of the universe did not have to go to borrow any material to create the universe. Because there was nobody to borrow it from, because it's like the creator and the creation are the same. So it talks about the lack of distinction between the jiva, my reality, my existence, my awareness, jagat, the entire universe, and the Ishvara, the creator. So jiva, Ishvara, jagat, there's no veda or there's no distinction at all. And it is by realizing that your oneness with all of this creation, that it's by my realization of this at all possible times that I undergo a cleansing of my maya or illusion, just by realizing my oneness with all of this. And then that is what we refer to as liberation or mukti, which is another conversation all by itself. Again, we know the Indian tradition does not believe the idea of salvation because there's no condemnation to start with. So it's no confrontatus maledictus. But it gives us freedom to sing confrontatus maledictus with the same reverence that we sing the hymns this morning. Just like Reverend Mitra was saying this morning. This freedom to relate to this reality. So now, if we define God as not distinct from creation, how do I relate to God? Now, does God have a name? Does he or she have a form? First of all, we start out by saying that in the Indian way of life looks at God as both male and female. God is both male and female. God can be male, God can be female, and God can be both male and female at the same time. In fact, there's an iconographic depiction of Shiva in the form of Ardhanarishvara, as he's called, where the left half of his body is female, and the right half of the body is male. And you can just Google it and find out. There's enough imagery all over the internet about Ardhanarishvara. So this just allows for the possibility that you're not limiting God in any possible way. The moment you put a limit on who God is, if the, suppose you call God a man, you're limiting God of all feminine powers. Think about Kathy, for example. Kathy is Dr. Catherine Roma. And she responds to Dr. Roma. I know the entire Martin Luther King choir refers to her as Dr. Roma. We call her Kathy. People refer to her as Catherine. And she's probably an aunt, a daughter, and a friend, and she probably responds to the word buddy, and so many other things. So it's like, but Kathy's a human being. She's not a god. If a human being, she's a goddess of music. If a human being that's in the midst of us can respond to so many different names, why cannot the superior power called God respond to so many different names and shapes of form? Why should he or she just be limited to a single name? Which is why in the Hindu religion you are permitted, or I mean nobody permits you, it's just allowed, it's just free to connect to the source in so many different ways, shapes and forms. You connect to God in the form of Shiva, you connect to the form of God, to the superior being in the form of Vishnu, this intelligent being in the form of Vishnu, or in the form of the mother whose form we just sang a few minutes ago. So there's so many different ways to relate to this reality. And which is why when you look at India, you see so many different temples, you see so many different deities, you see so many different worship traditions, which is why when the Western, when the colonizers looked at India, they found no way to understand this. They labeled this a polytheistic religion. And there's nothing wrong in calling this polytheistic in a figurative way, but it's not a monotheistic religion because it does not believe in a single God distinct from creation. Believes that everything is part of creation. So I think that explains the conversation that we had yesterday. Now, with respect to music itself, music is considered to be sacred. Because one of the fundamental beliefs in the Upanishads is that everything that exists is sacred. Does it mean nothing is secular? Everything is sacred, absolutely. The act of singing is sacred, the act of eating is sacred. The act of listening is sacred. So music itself is very sacred. It's an offering. In fact, if we had the time to plan to do one of the chants that we did in the World Choir Games, those are chants that would that show the relationship between the music and the meaning, and how these chants were preserved for generations together, and how the sound itself has a special significance. Instead, we will do a composition that's dedicated to music itself. It's called Tarana. So it's in this model that gives you unlimited ways to connect to the source. There's a healthy respect for every faith that exists on earth and many more come. So there's much that is actually a source of great inspiration. Why would you not respect another way that strives to relate to the same truth in a different way? After all, there's so much of different diversity. So much of diversity in the universe, and so diversity itself becomes a cause of celebration, a way of life itself. I want to leave behind four sayings, and the first one is called Swadesho Bhuvanantrayam, which is definition of patriotism. It means the entire universe is my motherland. The second one is Ishavasyam Idam Sarvam, which means everything that exists is sacred. Nahi Jnaneya Sadrisham Pavitra Miha Vidyate. What it means is, there's nothing as cleansing, as purifying as the knowledge of the self. And the final one is Vasudeva Kutumbakam. What it means is, the entire universe, all living beings and non-living beings, constitute one family. In this kind of a setup, what better prayer can you ask for than the following? May all be blessed with boundless joy. May all be free from needless fear. and this world, in this world of harmony, may peace and prosperity prevail. What I'm going to do is to invite the other Shanti singers to come and sing Sabbe Bhavantu Sukhinah with us.